I'm Jim Watkins, Associate Professor of English Rhetoric and Writing here at Berry. It's my pleasure tonight to welcome you to the second annual Buzz and Barbara Moten McCoy Southern Women Writers Lecture. But first I want to ask you to pull out those cell phones and silence them if you haven't done that already. Also, I want to mention that we're going to have books for sale afterwards, and Professor Howe will be available to sign those books and visit with you. So a little context first. This lecture series began with the biennial Southern Women Writers Conference, which was held at Berry from 1994 through 2012 for a total of 9 conferences. In 2006, Buzz and Barbara Moten McCoy generously endowed a lecture series for the conference's keynote address. And this lecture that you're attending tonight, this lecture series, stands as, It stands as a legacy of the conference. We are going to continue, as we did at the conference, to celebrate the written word and the women from the United States South who contributed to the region's rich literary heritage. And what we said about the conference back in the day remains equally true of this lecture series. It's especially fitting to focus on the accomplishments of Southern women writers here at an institution that not only values great writing, but also was founded by one of the original steel magnolias. And Barbara Moten McCoy was in the class of 1961, majored in English here at Berry. More recently, she served with distinction as a member of the executive steering committee for the college's successful $100 million century campaign. Her husband, Buzz, is a nationally recognized writer and teacher of business ethics who has served as executive in residence for the graduate business schools at Stanford University and Notre Dame, and as an adjunct professor at the Pacific School of Religion, UCLA's Anderson School of Management, and the University of Southern California's Graduate Real Estate Program. A retired Morgan Stanley executive, he has authored many works on the subjects of business ethics and real estate finance. The McCoys currently reside in Los Angeles. In addition to thanking the McCoys for their support, I would also like to thank the other members beside myself of the McCoy Speaker Series Committee. And those people are my colleague, Dr. Tina Booker, over there. And the two students on our committee are Olivia Murphy, raise your hand, Olivia, and Katie back there guarding the bookstore back there, Katie Marimas. It's my great honor tonight to introduce our distinguished speaker, Leanne Howe. She's a novelist, poet, playwright, filmmaker, tribal storyteller, scholar, and teacher. But she's coined a term, tribalographer, that encompasses all of those roles. Drawing on the one hand from the traditions of Native storytelling in general, in which an effort is made to show holistic connections between the story at hand and, well, everything in creation, and on the other hand from the Choctaw's tradition of diplomacy, in which an effort is made to find consensus through shared interests and common humanity, tribalography seeks simultaneously to remind tribal people of the power and values of their traditions while allowing non-Indians to better appreciate those traditions and to recognize the degree to which Native Americans have shaped what we've been taught to think of as a distinct and separate American culture and history. More specifically, Professor Howe is a Choctaw tribalographer, and it is the Choctaw's history and living culture that animate and inform her work most directly. Now, we're thinking about this as a Southern Women Writers Conference, Southern Women Writers series, so some of you may be a little bit confused about this, but just in case you didn't know, Oklahoma is a Southern state. Just ask the U.S. Census Bureau where it still lists Oklahoma as, and I guess Kentucky, the two states that didn't secede to slavery are still considered Southern states by the U.S. Census Bureau. In recent years, the majority of Oklahomans still self-identify as Southerners. I mean, after all, the south of the Mason-Dixon line was a slave state. But moreover, like the other 4 civilized nations of the southeastern U.S., the Choctaw see their tribal homeland in the lower Mississippi Valley. Their removal from Mississippi, Alabama, and Louisiana Louisiana in 1831-32 resulted in their own Trail of Tears that predates the Cherokee Trail of Tears by 6 years. Although I had known of the Treaty of Dancing Rabbit and the Choctaw removal most of my life and family in Mississippi, it wasn't until I read Professor Howe's novel Shell Shaker that I actually visualized the human dimensions of that historical tragedy and developed an inkling of an idea of what's at stake in the Choctaw's cultural, spiritual, and historical identification with their tribal homeland, epitomized by their reverence for Nonawaya, a sacred mound in eastern central Mississippi. As a Choctaw tribalographer, Professor Howe combines a reverence for all living things and a profound respect for tradition with a wry sense of humor and distinctly modern, global sensibility from which he builds communication and understanding across lines of ethnicity and nationality and across time. Professor Howe's first novel, Shell Shaker, published in 2001, is a complex and rewarding story with two parallel storylines, one in the lower Mississippi Valley during the mid-18th century before the American Revolution, and the other in late 20th century Oklahoma. Connected by the character Shakutina, a ceremonial shell shaker, the two plot lines converge into a vision of healing and return that binds the western and eastern bands of the Choctaw Nation. I loved reading Shell Shaker, but found even greater pleasure when I began teaching that novel to my students at Berry, and I know some of those students are here in this audience now. Her second novel, The Miko Kings, an Indian baseball story published in 2007, also involves two time settings, the present and early 20th century Oklahoma, and like Shell Shaker, immerses the reader in a rich tapestry of time and place that have been neglected in the standard histories. In this case, Indian baseball leagues in Indian country during the early 20th century. She's also published a collection of poems titled Evidence of Red in 2005. In 2011, she contributed to the scholarly book Reasoning Together, the Native Critics Collective. Her most recent book is a collection of essays, Chalk Talking on Other Realities, published in 2013. In addition to her fiction, essays, and poetry, she's written a play, The Mascot Opera of Minuet, and a screenplay for a documentary titled Indian Country Diary, Spiral of Fire, which was produced in 2006. More close to home for us here in Georgia, she's currently producing a documentary titled Searching for Sequoia about the famed Cherokee leader who invented the Cherokee Silver, and we look very much forward to seeing that documentary. Professor Howe's writing has earned her numerous awards and accolades, and a few of which include the United States Artist or USA Ford Fellowship, a Lifetime Achievement Award by the Native Writers Circle of the Americas, an American Book Award, the Oklahoma Book Award. She was a Fulbright Distinguished Scholar to Jordan. In October 2015, she received a Distinguished Achievement Award from the Western Literature Association. And in 2014, she received the Modern Languages Association inaugural prize for studies in Native American literatures, cultures, and languages. She shares a Native and Indigenous Studies Association Award for Literary Criticism with the other 11 scholars who contributed to Reasoning Together, named one of the 10 most influential books of the first decade of the 21st century for Indigenous scholarship. She's lectured nationally and internationally, giving the Richard Hogarth Series Lecture at Goldsmiths University of London, UK, in 2011, and the King's Lecture at the University of Kent, Canterbury, UK, 2013. And those are just a few. In 1993, she lectured throughout Japan as an American Indian representative during the United Nations International Year of Indigenous People. She also was the John and Renee Grisham Writer in Residence at the University of Mississippi in the 2006-2007 school year. She currently is the Eidson Distinguished Professor at the University of Georgia, where she teaches courses in Native American literature. Having had the pleasure of hearing her speak a few years back, I know we are all in for a real treat this evening, so will you please give a warm welcome to Professor Leanne Howe.
It is my pleasure to be here with you all. I'm really honored to be on this land, and I want to thank the people whose land this is for hosting many, many generations of people, all peoples here in Georgia, and what has become Georgia. I'm going to try to do several things tonight, and I can say completely, it has been such a delight to be here with colleagues, students, and to visit Professor Sandy's class and this afternoon. And it's just a beautiful campus, so I just want you to know that I've really, really enjoyed being here. And I want to read to you from something new and from something sort of new and something old. So that's how I'm going to try and contextualize the evening. I've been working on a book probably about 4 years, and it's called Savage Conversations, and it's between Mary Todd Lincoln and a savage Indian that she created. And she started telling her doctors that there was a savage Indian that was plaguing her each night in about 1873. It got really intense, and so by 1875, her son, there was an insanity trial, and they took 10 minutes to deliberate, and she was committed to Bellevue Institution in Batavia, Illinois in 1875. So I'm going to read a bit for a few poems from that, and then I'm going to read from Chalk Copy. I have never, ever written about another tribe, so this was my first foray, because how many of you have or have studied the Mankato hangings in 1863 that President Lincoln, his administration conducted? The Dakota Uprising, as it's known today, is a really sad piece of history. And President Lincoln, they started out with, they were going to hang 300 in this mass kind of opera of hangings. We're going to do it collectively. And he whittled the names down to 38. So they're known as the 38 Dakotas. And when Mary began this, these visions of a savage Indian who was plaguing her, I decided to believe her, that something must be going on for 2.5 years, and then finally it got really bad. Part of that reason is because she was on laudanum, and if any of you know anything about the drug, you know it's highly addictive, and it's also a wasting drug. It helps leach out a lot of your minerals, calcium from your bones, and so forth. So that's where this book came from, and I spent quite probably 4 years in study and research talking about it. So I'm going to read a little bit. This book should be out from Aunt Lute in the fall of this year, and UGA nicely, the theater department, read it as a play and did a reading of it last year. So I'm really honored by that. So I'm going to read just a bit from that and contextualize it. And then I'm going to read from something a little bit lighthearted. This is not. So President Abraham Lincoln gave the order to execute 38 Dakota Indians in Mankato, Minnesota, for their actions in the Dakota War against white settlers, who had first stolen their lands, then their rations, and then raped their women. At 10 a.m. on December 26, 1862, the synchronized hangings of 38 Dakota was and continues to be the largest mass execution in United States history. 4,000 settlers attended the execution. After the mass burial, the bodies of the American Indians were dug up by a local doctor and used as medical cadavers. Fast forward 11 years to November 1873, Dr. Willis Danforth of Illinois treats Mary Todd Lincoln for nervous derangement and fever in the head. He notes peculiar symptoms. Mrs. Lincoln tells him that someone is removing wires from her eyes, especially the left one, and cutting the bones from her cheeks. She attributes the fiendish work inside her head to an American Indian spirit. Nightly, she claims, he lifts her scalp and replaces it by dawn, sometimes cutting a bone out of her cheek. The Indian, she says, slits my eyelids and sews them open, always removing the wires by dawn's first light. Mrs. Lincoln's nervous condition becomes legendary, much to the dismay of her only surviving son, Robert Lincoln. In May 1875, Mary Todd Lincoln goes on trial in Chicago for insanity. Judge Marion Wallace presides. Robert testifies against his mother. The jury deliberates for 10 minutes before bringing in the verdict. They recommend that she be placed in an asylum, and Robert escorts Mary Todd Lincoln to Bellevue Place Sanatorium on Jefferson Street in Batavia. Once there, she's ensconced in a private residence of the home at Bellevue Place Sanatorium. Mary Todd Lincoln continues to blame an American Indian spirit for her madness. And I believe her. Apocrypha. June 1875, Bellevue Place, 333 South Jefferson Street, Batavia. Mary Todd Lincoln's suite at Bellevue Place. Although there's only one small bed and a bureau in her bedroom, Mary believes her residence sprawls over three large rooms, one containing a piano. Her residence is chock full of trunks, six carpet bags filled with footstools, silk curtains, jewelry, 15 pairs of kid gloves, exactly the same, and a few vials of laudanum hidden among her things. Savage Indian sits in a dark corner of the room. He wears a black vigilante town coat, the one he was hanged in. The coat droops open because the hangman's wife cut off the buttons to use on a new frock. Mary Todd Lincoln. Before you can think, you forget, then remember. A dress of blood, gloves I refuse to wash ever. What is it to a wild Indian? The president is shot. Fool, I was his all in all, his Molly, his child, wife, and mother, his puss. Savage Indian, thoughtfully. Well, he called me puss too. Catafalque, June 1875, Bellevue Place. Midnight, Mary's bedroom. She wears an off-white tattered nightdress. The underarms are badly soiled. Her small feet are swollen. The skin is paper thin. Savage Indian has a small box on his lap filled with her jewelry. He fingers each piece and finally fastens a pearl necklace around his neck. Mary Todd Lincoln. Nightly, I examine the ruined heads in my handheld mirror, yours and mine. Our eyes dangle like black dull grapes on a broken vine. Is it the candlelight? Savage Indian watches her with menacing eyes, but does not move. Mary Todd Lincoln. I touch the blemish on your face, Finger your blood-stained shirt. A drop of spittle has escaped your tight lips, your bare feet clammy as fish, all there and here. I kiss the mirror. Beg you to wake. Fight to catch your attention through some mad theatrical gesture. Remember? My bed, always a catafalque to you. Oh, let fly my flesh, hair, and eyelash. Pay the nightjars who regularly serenade, but like us, steal the milk of goats. Here, at last, I'll tell it all. I did wish you dead, sir. 8,039 times for all the days you ran sideways from our home, whistling a nightjar's tune. Pay them all now, sir, before dawn's light. Savage Indian reads aloud the inscription of her wedding ring. Love is eternal. Catafalque 2. June 1875, Bellevue Place, Mary Todd Lincoln. Arriving nightly without invitation, you make my room a ceremony as nightjars sing, wing clap, chirp a bird song, inhibited at dawn by God's will, like us. When shall I tell them the truth? Where shall I keep the truth? Under my frayed petticoat, it will not flower now. There is no need to wait for tea. I confess, I did long for the pleasure of your coarse skin, money to spend, kid gloves, chiffon and satin, ball gowns with lavish trains, properly hemmed, and doomed children. Tonight, let us hoist the catafalque over a new grave. Hold my hands above the dank earth as the nightjar serenade. Oh, what a great heart smasher you are, Mr. Lincoln. Adieu, my confessor, my all in all, lover, protector, ghost, husband. Wishing for nothing, not even breath. Take the flint knife. Cut me, I dare you. And I think I'll end this. This is a long piece. So this is, I'll finish up from this new book. This is called A Long Night's Moon. June, 1875, Bellevue Place. 4 a.m., Mary Todd Lincoln's rooms. Many candles light the space. The air is hot and stifling. Savage Indian shackles Mary Todd Lincoln to the chair for the 57th time tonight. Gar woman. That is your true name. Gar feed at night, sometimes eat their own eggs. We will all once fish. The scent of a woman during copulation reminds us. Mary Todd Lincoln. Vulgarity at last, just like my Mr. L. He once asked me why a woman was like a barrel. Savage Indian shrugs. Mary Todd Lincoln giggles. You have to raise the hoops before you can put the head in. Savage Indian breathes deeply through his nose, snorts out bad air, leaves her side and walks around her bedroom. Mary Todd Lincoln. Fiend, he was my lover, father, and comedian. Savage Indian sniffles and pinches her things. The knit comb on her bureau intrigues him the most. Fishy in here. Mary Todd Lincoln smooths the wrinkles of her sour nightdress, the one she's worn since March 12, 1875. Ghoul, specter, poltergeist, banshee, you are the fishy one. Savage, be gone from my head. Savage Indian. Quiet, someone is coming. Very Todd Lincoln. No doubt the wandering Jew. Nightly he steals my pocketbook. Savage Indian. Hush! Be still. He moves in closely, gently caresses her face, takes the smallest sharp flint from his leather pouch, slits the soft skin above each eyelid, then sews it firmly open with a thread of silver filigree. Mary Todd Lincoln, ecstatic. Oh, at last. I can see the world as it truly is. And so that's a little bit from the new book. And it finishes up with those two before they head for PAL France. So I'm going to switch gears a little bit and read from Talking on Other Realities. This is a little bit lighter. By the way, everything in that text, her comments about the wandering Jew, all those pet names, the silver filigree, all those came from her letters or the letters by the doctor or by Robert Todd Lincoln. Not long before she's finally released, the doctor at Bellevue writes Robert Todd Lincoln, who's on his way to visit her, he says, turn around, your mother has a gun and she is going to shoot you with it if you arrive, so please don't come until we're able to take away the pistol from her. And so there's a lot of violence in her feelings for her only surviving son, Robert. So I was quite surprised by a lot of the things that I had researched. And apparently, I'll just say this, everybody in there, all the historians, knew that she'd invented a savage Indian to torture her. But they just thought, oh, well, she's having a bad few years. And but when I read that, I thought, I see this completely different. It's not that she's just having a bad year. It reveals a kind of general, I think, a very general feeling about the way the Lincolns, their administration, and certainly General Grant felt about Native people in that era. And so it made sense at a certain level that she would choose Natives to be a Native, to be her torturer. So, having said that, I'm going to read from Chalk Talking. So this is a collection of stories, I call it memoir, and because they're travel stories and from all over the place, where I was in Japan, I've gone to Romania, the Middle East, and had all these kind of adventures. So kind of enjoyed it, but the trip to Japan was the most difficult, I think, of all the trips possibly ever taken. I tried to fit in, and I wasn't able to. I just made one cultural mistake after another, and people were crying at dinner, and where I went, people cried, and so it was terrible. It was terrible. And so this story is called "I Fuck Up in Japan," and it's about that trip in 1993 I took. So the first time I experienced a heated toilet seat was in Okayama City, Japan, February 1993. Some cross-cultural experiences do not easily translate into words. Using a heated toilet seat may be one of them. It was my first trip to the Far East. Before I completed the 3-week tour, giving lectures to Japanese groups and visiting with local dignitaries in towns and cities, I would have diverse experiences with all manner of toilets and washing apparatus associated with the ofuro, the Japanese bath. I've been invited to Japan as an American Indian representative to speak at the International Forum on Anti-Discrimination and Human Rights during the 1993 United Nations International Year of the World's Indigenous People. A mouthful, but it was serious stuff. The plan was for me to do homestays with local host families throughout Japan and learn about their culture. Ditto for the Japanese. They would learn about me. My tribe was once bullish on homestays. In the 18th century, Choctaws were awash in foreigners. The French, the Alsatians, the Germans, the Swiss, the Irish, the Scots, the occasional Spaniard, a menacing Englishman roaming here and there, all doing immersive family experiments in our homelands. Historic homestays were intended as a kind of tourism between different peoples from different lands. I know what you're thinking. It didn't work out for Choctaws and every other American Indian tribe. But since this was the end of the 20th century, I hoped for a better outcome. I prepared myself for investigating the cultural spine of Japan with exploratory questions in English, such as, how do you live? What is your work? Where is the bathroom? In return, I would reveal what I know of my own cultural anatomy. I am Choctaw, an American Indian from the United States. Yes, perhaps I do carry the genes of other hereditary ancestors. Our ancient mothers took homestays seriously. Of course, you may try on my red beaded warrior coat. Remarkable! The coat does make you look just like an American Indian, although it's two sizes too big. I had a month to prepare for my trip to Japan, but wasted a fair amount of time writing chapter titles for a travel book I would write. Quote, my travels in the land of the rising sun, end quote. An American Indian amongst the samurai. Sushi or whale blubber? Why, I chose whale. The last chapter was bound to get the attention of the environmentalist. Controversy sells, you know. All this was absolute lunacy. I should have spent my time learning Japanese. I didn't know a single word when I agreed to do the lectures. Of course, I carried a journal with me that had a few words spelled out phonetically. Ohio gozaimasu, good morning. Konnichiwa, good day. Konbanwa, good evening. Sama, gives praise to the one who makes the meal. Idakimasu, I humbly receive. Note that these words are responses to polite conversational banter. I'd also foolishly written out a few sentences I could read aloud if asked about my family. Rare was the opportunity, however, I could bow properly, hold my journal in one hand, and read the correct words at just the right time. I'd been taught how to bow like a woman by a male Japanese professor at the University of Iowa, where I was working as a staff person in international education. And I practiced several times in front of the mirror and thought I was prepared for genteel interactions. So far, so good. During the first week in Japan, I stayed in hotels and was hosted by Professor Mitsuhito Kanihara of Hosei University in Tokyo. He spoke English in a soft voice that made me wonder if all Japanese men converse with such a gentle countenance. After 8 days, he took me to stay with my first host family in Okayama City, where the Human Rights Forum was to take place. So, my Japanese toilet event. It caught cold spell swept across the entire country the night of my first homestays. Temps plummeted below freezing. Most Japanese homes didn't have central heating or air conditioning. In a normal February, a vent-free space heater that rolled from room to room would be adequate. But this wasn't an average February. At dusk, heavy, wet snow fell and continued throughout the night. My host family and I communicated through body language and hand gestures. A smile was happiness. Hands on the heart expressed gratitude. And I was assured in an official letter from the Braku Liberation League given to me by my host that a translator was on the way the next day. He would accompany me for the rest of my journey throughout Japan and translate my lectures. In the meantime, I was on my own. We went to bed early and my host shut off the space heater to conserve energy. By midnight, I had to go to the bathroom. The marble tiled room was lovely, yet bitter as a tomb. I began peeling off the 7 layers of clothing I'd worn to bed, including a red pair of Land's End long johns. I noted furry material covering the toilet seat while stripping off my clothes, but ignored it. Naked, I sat down, jumped up, and then panicked. Wires inside fur. I'm gonna be electrocuted, I hissed. I flashed on an image of Elvis Presley sitting on the commode just before his ginormous, bloated body dolloped onto the floor. Oh God, I can't end up like that. The room was so frigid I could see my breath. I didn't know what to do. I never felt a woolly toilet seat cover before, let alone a woolly heating pad. My mind was a feverish tangle of questions. What if a loose wire gets wet? What happens? What if the mishap carries enough current to shock my heart and in a split second I'm history, killed by gadgetry? Will my Navy friends laugh at the irony? Will my loved ones angrily complain I should never have traveled to Japan in the first place? While Elvis Presley died of an overdose from mixing 10 kinds of pills into a lethal cocktail that would at last quench his thirst, I'd had no intoxicants since arriving at Narita International Airport. Not even beer or wine, just buckets of hot green tea. I ran my trembling hands through my hair and shivered. Stop thinking about Elvis Presley, I said through clenched teeth. Oh, that's beside the freaking point. I closed my eyes. All I could see was a bare red body cupped beside an icy, cold porcelain throne. An ode to modernity. A few more seconds passed. At last, I opened my eyes. The toilet and I regarded one another.
Kanbanwa,
I said softly. Then I bowed slowly as I'd been taught, sat down, and hoped not to die. I did not die. What I wouldn't know until much later is that there would be many times during my travels across Japan that I will wish I were dead. I was out of my depth, out of my mind, using the wrong words, consistently acting on the wrong assumptions, making too many cross-cultural mistakes. Oklahoma could not have prepared me for the Far East. And so I'm gonna skip over to another section in this story. It's actually kind of long. It's about 28,000 words, and it covers most of my heinous events in which people are crying or throwing their chopsticks across the table at me. Just read this section. When a writer starts working on a piece, I thought, I'd taken a lot of notes while I was in Japan and a lot of pictures, and I thought it would be one gag after another. And it wasn't until I finished the piece that I realized that this story was really about my uncles. So I'm going to read to you this section in which my uncles, both of my uncles, who were soldiers in World War II and had been Slish, my older uncle, had survived the Battle of the Bulge. And I realized this cross-cultural travel that I was on was really about them. So here's another section of that story. On February 19th, M. Kamihara and I traveled by train to the West Shinto shrines and later a famous Buddhist shrine in Kanagawa Prefecture. He'd taken a few days off from his university work to show me around Japan. We talked. His academic specialty was ethnic literature translations, and he said he was interested in native fiction writers. It was through his mother's connection with the Bracken Liberation League that he was able to invite me. He told me that discriminatory practices against the Bracken people in Japan have a long and complicated history, much like the prejudices against American Indians in the United States. Discrimination against Bracken people has nothing to do with race, though. Language or customs or religions, Bracken are wholly Japanese, unlike the Ainu, who are the indigenous people of Japan, or the Koreans of Japan, who were brought in as forced laborers from 1939 to 1945. Bracken history can be traced to feudalism of the Tokugawa shogunate starting in the 16th century. Under shogunate rule, people were put into four classes according to their occupations. These classes were assumed to be the natural order of descending importance. Below the four classes were other groups of people known as outcasts or the untouchables, with occupations thought to be polluting, demanding, or undesirable. The untouchables were butchers, leather craftsmen, entertainers, and flower arrangers. In other words, they were artists. It's hard to understand, isn't it? I said. Bracken people are the same as mainstream Japanese in all ways, but they're treated differently like a racial minority in the United States. Yes, answered Kanihara. The Brackenmead are members of a socially constructed minority. But isn't that the story in all societies? How does one know if they're about to marry a Bracken person or a mainstream Japanese? The genealogy records of families go back centuries, he said. Mothers and grandmothers can have the research done to make sure their daughters or granddaughters are not married into a Bracken family, he said. We then headed to the great Buddha of Kamakura in Kanagawa Prefecture. It was a bright and sunny day at the site and felt so much warmer than Tokyo. Throughout the rest of the day, we talked about various nuances in the works of American Indian writers. I brought gifts for my Japanese host, books by N. Scott Momonade, Leslie Marmon Silko, Holligan Allen, Linda Hogan, Louise Erdrich, and Vinda Loria Jr. He told me the names of some American Indians that had been translated into Japanese as quote-unquote native. Jamaki Highwater is not an American Indian, I said bluntly. M. Kanihara appeared pensive. Highwater lied about his identity so much that eventually the Smithsonian investigated his claims. I explained that Jamaki Highwater had a colorful but contradictory personal story. He first said he was born in Los Angeles, then Canada. He said he was French-Canadian, then Blackfeet. He applied for all kinds of American Indian scholarships, and he received the money. M. Connie Harrop was thoughtful and didn't respond. "This is fraud," I said angrily. As we sat in front of the 13-meter-high bronze statue of the Buddha, I couldn't stop talking about ethnic fraud and how they were the modern equivalent of 19th-century Indian agents. In light of all the problems facing the world's indigenous peoples, I knew the fraudulent identity issue sounded trivial, but I wouldn't let it go. I yammered on and on like some kind of maniac. I don't excuse my irreverence at the temple site except to say I wasn't seeing the statue of the Buddha, nor was I seeing the other tourists there. I was seeing Choctaw people in the lower Mississippi Valley in 1738. Smallpox blankets arrived in the east and were traded west along with the smell of oblivion. Gifts from hairy-fingered foreigners. I was seeing our warriors fall and get up, then walk through a door that centuries later I would emerge from, my fist clenched at birth. Who wants to fight? I was seeing myself a warrior engaged in a desperate battle I will not win. Enemies on all sides, then suddenly I awakened in the sunlight, surrounded by lush greenery and hackberry trees, frightened by the raging woman I'd become at the Buddhist shrine. While our tribes are fighting the government and federal court, these ethnic frauds market themselves as medicine men, charging hundreds of dollars to unwitting people who want an exotic Indian ceremony. M. Connie Harrop was solemn now, withdrawn. I bullied him into silence. When he finally spoke, I measured the distance of the words between what he said and what he thought. I liked M. Connie Harrop, yet I'd shown myself a fool. I'd wounded him, a man gracious enough to bring me to Japan. I dug in my purse for a tissue to wipe my eyes and pulled out my journal, something to write on, something to write on, something to mark my shame. Suddenly a band of Japanese Baptist missionaries swept by us, fervently praising God as they passed around a collection plate at the great Buddha of Kamakawa. Just as we're about to lose our bearings, fate lends a hand, he says serenely. I looked up from my journal and tried to smile. M. Connie Harrop stood up, his face tranquil, eyes judicious, regretting me. Yet he was deferential. He said that we should circle the large stationary object that may or may not have known it was being watched. After we circled the Buddha, I walked alone for a time outside the sanctuary, thinking about the images I just conjured up. Memories. Whose are they? Is this pain I carry mine or my family's? Does it come through blood ties, stories, or both? And if so, we're all carriers. Facing toward the Buddha, I silently ask again, whose memories? Then listen to the weight of knowing. Lloyd E. Billy died in World War II, shot to pieces 2 weeks after his 19th birthday. My uncle, just a boy really, only 5'3" tall, 124 pounds. At 16, Lloyd enlisted in September of 1940 on the same day as his older brother, Slish Billy, who was 3 months shy of his 20th birthday. Lloyd lied on his enlistment application saying he was 19. Both my uncles listed actor as their civil occupations. Apparently no one in the enlistment office could read irony. Uncle Lloyd was a fighter. I have pictures of him in boxing gloves, dukes up. He fought in amateur boxing matches in McAllister and wanted to become a Golden Gloves champion. Because he'd only finished grammar school, he became a private eventually serving in the Army's Company F, 180th Infantry Regiment, 45th Infantry Division. Uncle Slish was a second lieutenant in command of Fox Company and Lloyd's commanding officer. Over the course of Slish's service, he was wounded 4 times and received a Purple Heart, a Good Conduct Medal, an American Defense Service Ribbon, a European African Medal with a cluster of 5 bronze stars and 2 silver stars. He was also a talk-talk code talker in World War II. In 2008, Slish was awarded a Congressional Gold Medal posthumously, along with all the other talk-talk code talkers of World War I and World War II. But Slish's greatest act of heroism might have been pulling his brother up off the ground the day Lloyd died. Together, they took a step forward into hope and then acceptance, a specimen of ruin. The pure light that took Uncle's place that day still remembers him, as does his family. Carrying the memory of it is hard. Without warning, it can cut through flesh and bone, revealing its truest nature, a crushed diamond. Later that evening, after M. Kanihara dropped me at my hotel, I searched in my purse for another tissue and found a small pamphlet titled The Great Buddha of Kanihara. I'd forgotten I had it. One of the lines jumped out at me. The central teaching is that through devotion to Amida Buddha, expressed through mantras and sincerity of the heart, one will go to the pure land or western paradise after death, a pleasant realm from which it is easy to attain nirvana. Idakimasu, I said quietly as a prayer, both hands on my heart. I humbly receive. Thank you. Life everlasting. Hey, Kana, I am finished talking. Thank you again. Now, if you have any questions, I'm happy to answer them about Choctaws or about writing or my work as a scholar. Dun, 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 dun. I once asked this question years ago, and somebody in the audience says, do Choctaws keep cats? I said, yes. Next question. So, anything you'd like to know about writing? Yes.
Not about writing, but about history. I didn't know that there were Choctaw code talkers. Everyone hears about the Navajo. Was there something about the Choctaw language that was especially befuddling to everybody besides Choctaws?
Yes. Choctaws are the first code talkers in World War I. And so Navajos are latecomers. Not that they didn't do a great job, but they're only in World War II. We were in World War I, and we're the first tribe to send code talkers, and the Germans never decoded Choctaw language. And so after that, during World War II, Slish and Loy and Lonnie, those are my 3 uncles. Slish and Lonnie both survived. Loy was killed. Lonnie was a code talker in Patton's army. And so in 2012, 1912, the tribe had a huge celebration for the Choctaw Code Talkers and all their families. And that's and passed out these their what they had done in World War II and World War I to the families. So it was a wonderful commemoration of the men who served, especially in World War I, because people don't know that. His name is Okahombee, captured 117 Germans by himself and walked them into detention. And he didn't speak English. And so that's a story that is part of a documentary that's being made. And he came from Batiste, Oklahoma, what became Oklahoma. He was born, oh, I don't know, probably 1890s, and before statehood. And so, yeah, there's a lot of history about that. And I think, if you want to know what I think, and I think that those kinds of code talking were not something new. I think it was something very old and something that they had done with many other tribes that they were fighting with during that time with the French and the Spanish. They used different kinds of codes to trick up the Creeks that were here, and it worked. That's my theory, anyway. Yeah, thanks for asking. Any other questions? Y'all are quiet. Okay, thank you very much for having me, and I'm happy to sign books.